Random House Audiobooks presents All Over But the Shoutin' by Rick Bragg. Read for you by the author.
All Over But the Shoutin'. I used to stand amazed and watch the redbirds fight. They would flash and flutter like scraps of burning rags through a sky unbelievably blue. Once, when I was little, I watched one of the birds attack its own reflection in the side mirror of a truck. It hurled its body again and again against that unyielding image, until the whole mirror was smeared with blood. It was as if the bird hated what it saw there, and discovered too late that all it was seeing was itself. It was just its nature. This is not an important story. It is only the story of a strong woman, a tortured man, and three sons who lived hemmed in by thin cotton and ragged history in northeastern Alabama, in a time when blacks and whites found reason to hate each other, and a whole lot of people could not stand themselves. Anyone could tell it. Anyone with a daddy who let his finer nature slip away from him during an icebound war in Korea, who allowed the devil inside him to come grinning out every time a sip of whiskey trickled in, who finally just abandoned his young wife and sons. Anyone could tell it. Anyone who had a mama who went 18 years without a new dress so that her sons could have school clothes, who picked cotton in other people's fields and cleaned the mess in other people's houses so that her children didn't have to live on welfare alone, so that one of them could climb up her backbone and escape the poverty and hopelessness. Anyone could tell it, and that's the shame of it. A lot of women stood with babies on their hips in line for commodity cheese and peanut butter. A lot of men were damaged deep inside by the killing and dying of wars, then tried to heal themselves with a snake oil elixir of sour mash and self-loathing. A lot of families just came to pieces in that time and place and condition, like paper lace in a summer rain. This story is important only to me and a few people who lived it, people with my last name. I tell it because there should be a record of my mama's sacrifice, even if it means unleashing ghosts. Because it is one of the few ways I can think of to repay her for all the suffering and indignity she absorbed for us, for me. And I tell it because I can, because it is how I earn my paycheck, now at the New York Times, telling stories. It is easy to tell a stranger's story. I didn't know if I had the guts to tell my own. I've been putting this off for 10 years. It was death that made me hurry, but not my father's. He died 20 years ago, tubercular. His insides pickled by whiskey and beer. Being of long memory, my mama, my brothers, and I did not go to the cemetery to sing hymns or see him remanded to the red clay. Our mama went alone to the funeral home one night when it was just him and her. No, the death that made me finally sit down to write was that of my grandmother, my mother's mother, Ava, who we all called by her pet name, Abigail. Miss Ab, who after enduring 86 years of this life, died of pneumonia 2 days before Thanksgiving, 1994. I was in New Orleans, writing about the deaths of strangers. I was sitting in a cramped living room in a crumbling housing project, listening to a hollow-eyed young woman tell me how her little boy had been killed one morning by a stray bullet as he stood in the doorway, book satchel in his hand, like a little man going to work. She told me how the Dr. Seuss and Winnie the Pooh just fell out on the stoop, how the boy looked up at her after the bullet hit, wide-eyed, wondering. As I left, shaking her limp hand, she thanked me. I had to ask why. She answered by pulling out a scrapbook of her baby's death, cut from the local newspaper. People remembers it, she said. People forgets if it ain't wrote down. I reckon so. The next morning, the death I was called to was personal. My grandmother, who fried me whole boneyards of chicken, who played boiling cabbage down on the banjo, was gone. I came home to a coldly modern funeral home, to the people of our community sitting quietly in their pews. These were people who remembered the weight of the cotton sack, people who built redwood decks on their mobile homes and have no idea that smart-aleck Yankees think that is somehow funny. People of the Pines, my people. I came home to a pale and elegant body in an open coffin, her thin hands crossed on her breast. I've made my living in graveyards of spirit, in the blasted-out, crack-infested streets of Miami's Liberty City, in the insane hallways of Manhattan's welfare hotels, in the projects in Birmingham, and in the reeking oceanfront slums of Port-au-Prince, and on death rows in 3 states. I've seen so many horrible things in so many horrible places that I have suspicions about God and doubts about heaven. But in that funeral home, I found myself wishing for it, envisioning it. I bet even God, unless he is an Episcopalian, likes a little fade o'doe every now and then, and a lot to think of her up there, blowing a hurricane on her harmonica and singing a little too loud. A million sights and sounds rang through my head as I stared down at her. I thought about the times when I was still a little boy, no more than 5, when she'd let me sleep at the foot of her bed so we could listen to her Philco, how I drifted off to sleep with the tinny voices of Farron Young, Little Jimmy Dickens, Bill Monroe, and Mother Maybelle Carter in chorus inside my head. It was one of the benefits of being old, she told me. You can play your radio all damn night long if you want to, and no one can do a damn thing about it. Like everyone in that part of the world, she'd been enraptured by a young, thin man from Mount Olive, Alabama, Hank Williams, who sang with a twisted spine and a tortured spirit. And she would whirl the dial over and over again, searching for his words. She told me she saw him once, back before he died, but she was flying pretty high on her medicine that night, and might have told a lie. She felt that another benefit of old age was that it gave you license to lie like a Republican. But it was then, as that dead man's poetry ran through my mind, as I stared down at that old woman I'd seen for just a few hours a year on Thanksgiving and Christmas because I wrongly believed I was doing more important things, that I knew I should not wait any longer to write some of this down, whether anybody ever read it or not. Maybe, if I tell it right, she'll live again. And all the things she could have shared about who we are, who I am, will not be so badly missed. I like to believe that. I already know a good bit about my history, stories that were seldom written down, only passed from one to another of us over the endless, beautiful, hateful rows of cotton that I still dream about even today, even though the fields lie in trash and weeds. I know I was born during one of those periods when my father had abandoned my mother, that, and I still do not know whether to laugh or cry about this, he did not bother to come and see me until I was almost 2 years old. I know he brought a stuffed panda bear as big as God, and I dragged it around until he was one-eared and his eyes fell off. And I remember running with it, too heavy, when I was a few years older, running down a dirt road in the night from him. I know I grew up in a time when a young man in a baggy suit and slicked down hair talked hot and mean about the colored, giving my poor and desperate people a reason to feel superior to somebody, to anybody. I know that even as the words of George Wallace rang through my Alabama, the black family who lived down the dirt road sent fresh-picked corn and other food to the poor white lady and her 3 sons, because they knew their daddy'd run off, because hungry does not have a color. I know that a few weeks later he whirled through our house in a drunken rage, and as always our mama just absorbed it, placing herself like a wall between her husband and sons. I know that later my older brother Sam and I lay in the dark and tried to figure out a way to kill a grown man before he hurt her anymore. I know that I had a third brother, an infant, who died because we were left alone and with no money for my mama to see a doctor, that he did not live long enough to have a name. I know his gravestone just reads Baby Bragg, and my mama never mentioned him to us for 30 years, but carried his memory around deep inside her like a piece of broken glass. I know that my mother was not afraid of much. I watched her doing a 4-foot rattlesnake with a rake and a Red Ryder BB gun, and that she could have handled life with him if it had just been him and her without the ghosts. I could see them only in my father's almost pathological fear of cold and his hatred of ice. I saw them on a winter day in 1965 when my little brother stepped through the ice in a pond, when my daddy snatched him up and ran all the way to the house, his face white as frost. Know that my father had not always been the tortured man of my childhood, that when he started courting my mama, a tall, serenely beautiful woman who looked like a 1940s movie star, he'd worn pants with creases sharp enough to slice bologna. I know he had once been just a slight, dark, part Cherokee man who had a reputation for being a little too quick to pull his knife, who could not hold his liquor, but who consumed life in great gulps. And I know that something happened to him in those years when he was a Marine in Korea, something involving a bitter cold night in a place he could not spell or even pronounce. And I know that after that he was too often mean and cold and a little crazy, and kept a secret that he only talked about when he was either knee-walking drunk or scared of dying, like he was at the end when he called me to his side and told it. I know a good bit. It is the truth as well as I can tell it. And if it causes anyone shame or anger, I am truly sorry.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.